The clock has struck, and so welcome this afternoon to this, I think, very special occasion. It is our honor to have Max Boot, a distinguished fellow here at the Council, one of our longtime colleagues, to talk about his new book, War Made New, which is a really important book, and I mean that in every sense of the word. Every so often a book comes along that fundamentally crystallizes and helps people to understand what is really going on in the world. And this is one of those books. It follows closely on another book that Max published some years ago called The Savage Wars of Peace, which has been a very significant part of hopefully new thinking that that is in the process of transforming the way our leadership in and out of government thinks about the world we live in. First, a few words about the ground rules. This session, unlike many, is on the record. And we will keep our bloviation to about 20 minutes, and then we'll go into questions from the floor. And at 7 o'clock, we will shut down. And then we have a reception and a book signing, again, right across the hall. So we hope that all of you will be able to join us after the session. Max needs no introduction, but I am ever mindful of the time when I introduced my former boss and our beloved colleague Henry Kissinger at a session with, and here is a man that needs no introduction, and he took me aside very angry afterwards and said, "Lehman, don't you understand? Those who are introduced as needing no introduction are the ones who crave it the most." So knowing Max's craving, I'll do a little compromise in that you all have in your papers Max's detailed and very interesting and distinguished biography. He is from California, from the left coast, and went to Berkeley and did his master's degree at Yale, and has had a distinguished career in journalism as well as his scholarly pursuits with the Christian Science Monitor and the Wall Street Journal. That you will have to suffice for your craving. And so I'd like to get into the book. It's an exciting book for those of us who have spent our careers in military affairs and national security. It's a book you literally can't put down. It is full of so many interesting new insights that you kind of say, why didn't I think of that? And so many new facts and new hypotheses and new correlations. It's really a neat book. And so I think what we'd like to do, Max has a little laryngitis from, I guess, answering so many questions about the book. And so we'll try to keep the talk succinct. And I would hope when we get to questions, you will all be equally succinct and to the point without speeches. And we should really walk out of here very much enlightened. So, Max, why don't you start by telling us why you took this approach? Why did you do this book? And why did you pick this approach? And why did you pick these four transformational periods, which are really revolutions in the way of war?
Well, I will be delighted to do that, but let me just begin by throwing out a few words of thanks. As you can tell, John was not exaggerating when he said, I have laryngitis, I really do, but I will soldier on, and if necessary, I will resort to sign language. First, let me just thank you for that generous introduction, and thank you for hosting this event. I'd like to thank the council for not only hosting the event, but for hosting me over the course of the last 4 years. This has been a truly wonderful place to work, and I thank Les Kelb for hiring me, and I thank Richard Haas for not firing me. And there's some other people I'll just briefly thank who are in the room, including my publisher, Bill Schenker from Gotham Books, my agents, Glenn Hartley and Lynn Chu, who have been wonderful counselors to me, and not least of all, my wife sitting somewhere in the back there, very modestly, but she has been an integral player in all this as well. Now, I'm not ducking your question. I'm actually getting to it. And the question is, how did I choose this approach? And it was basically because I became interested in this debate over revolutions and military affairs and over the information revolution, this debate we've really been having since the 1991 Gulf War, which showed this full panoply of high-tech weapon systems unveiled and used on the battlefield. And ever since then, we've been having a debate within defense circles and the larger community concerned about defense over what does this mean? What are the implications for defense policy going forward? Does this overthrow everything that we know about warfare and necessitate an entirely new kind of military? And that's kind of the most radical position. But this has been something debated heatedly over the course of the last 15 years. And my sense is that very often there has been more heat than light cast on this discussion. And being a historian, what I want to do is approach this issue historically by looking not only at this current information revolution, but at previous revolutions in military affairs, these upheavals when you have new technology combining with new doctrine, new training, new organization to change what happens on the battlefield and the global balance of power. And looking back over the course of the last 500 years or so, I found four such major changes to look at, starting with the gunpowder revolution around 1500, then the first industrial revolution, which really transformed warfare from about 1850 to 1914, from the Crimean War to World War I, then the second industrial revolution with tanks and airplanes and radios and all the rest, which made its impact felt in the 20s and 30s, with the full consequences being obvious in World War II, and now the information revolution, which is being driven by advances in microchip technology, especially since the 1960s. So where I sort of come down in the book is this: yes, there has been an information revolution. There has been a revolution in military affairs, but as I suspect we'll talk about in a minute or two, the implications are not exactly those that we anticipated or those envisioned by the advocates of this so-called revolutionary hypothesis.
Well, that's a very good introduction, and we'll see as this unfolds the law of unintended consequences in each of these revolutions brings many lessons, and we'll, I'm sure, when we get to the Q&A, dwell a bit on how we apply these lessons from these four epochs to the challenges we face today. So, first, why don't we start with the first revolution and the introduction of gunpowder. Gunpowder having been around for a very long time in China and elsewhere, but at first really had a revolutionary impact beginning in the 15th century. So why don't you talk a little bit about that revolution and how it evolved and what did it revolutionize?
The very first battle that I talk about in my book is the French invasion of Italy in 1494, which is not much remembered today, but it was really a revolutionary development because the French were bringing cannons into Italy, this peninsula of city-states that sheltered behind feudal castle walls, and all of a sudden the French were knocking down the castle walls with their newfangled artillery. And this was the set-in in train, an upheaval that lasted at least a couple of hundred years that transformed warfare on land as well as at sea, with truly profound geopolitical consequences. The biggest consequence was simply that the Europeans now had 3-masted sailing ships armed with cannons, which allowed them to go to the furthest corners of the world and impose their dominance on people all around the world. And this set in motion the rise of the West from, you know, in 1450, where I begin my book, Europeans controlled about 14% of the world's land surface. By 1914, Europeans controlled about 84% of the world's land surface. And this was largely because of their success in taking advantage of the gunpowder revolution and then the first industrial revolution. But within Europe, not only the gunpowder revolution had variable consequences for various states, because some states were very good at taking advantage of it and others weren't. As I mentioned, I started off with the French invasion of Italy in 1494. You know, the Italian city-states were perfectly viable entities in the pre-gunpowder age. They could afford to survive and even thrive as these tiny little entities, but that was no longer the case once gunpowder came along, and the cost of fielding an army or even defending yourself against the siege rose astronomically, with the rising cost of weapons and large armies and so forth. And what this did was it empowered not the little feudal lords who had ruled Europe during the Middle Ages, but these super lords, these absolute monarchs. And so what you had was the rise of modern nation states, whether Britain or France, Prussia, Russia, Austria, Sweden, all these modern nation states essentially rose largely as a result of the gunpowder revolution. So the consequences could not have been more profound in imposing the will of Europe upon the world and imposing the will of a handful of monarchs upon Europe.
One of the things that makes this such a fascinating book, and one that everybody in this business needs to read and understand, is how well you illustrate the interaction of technology and the human factor. Because simultaneously, as you describe the 15th century, in China, you had technology that was far advanced. They were building ships that were, you know, hundreds of years more advanced technologically with water making and so forth. And they had gunpowder. They had it for a long time. And yet, because of the internal politics in China, all of that was destroyed. And after they had gotten some say all the way to the United States, the Americas, but we certainly know they got to the east coast of Africa, and then all disappeared, and they went into a long technological Egyptian night from which they are hardly even recovered today because of the human leadership that took them down a very different road. And this runs, this human interaction with technology runs through every chapter of your book, which I think is terrific because you illustrate it so well in the how it has operated in history, with lessons to how it operates today in Washington and the Pentagon. Let's go to the first industrial revolution, and Königsberg as an example.
Well, it took a long time for industrial technology to really make its way into warfare. I mean, when you think about the steam engine being invented in the mid-18th century, but not really being integrated into warfare until the mid-19th century, with the steamships, railroads, and then also other technologies such as rifles, repeating rifles, machine guns, and all the rest. What this did was, on the global sphere, to complete the European conquest of the essentially the rest of the world. People, you know, historians still debate, why did you have the scramble for Africa? Why in the course of the last 20 years of the 19th century did Europeans all of a sudden take over Africa? Well, there are a lot of reasons for it, but I think the essential element is it was easy to do. And the reason it was easy to do was all of a sudden Europeans had gunboats, they had machine guns, they had railroads, they had defenses against tropical diseases, so they were able to wage these wars on the cheap in some ways, similar to the way that we were able to wage wars in the 1990s in Kosovo and Bosnia on the cheap. And so, geopolitically, you saw the furthest extension of European dominance that you've ever seen. And then within Europe, you saw this period of upheaval where certain states were better than others at mastering gunpowder technology and the Industrial Revolution, which came along after. And the state that was the most successful within Europe of taking advantage of the first Industrial Revolution was Prussia. And I write about the Battle of Koniggratz in 1866, which is not one that we pay enough attention to, but it was really pivotal in the rise of a unified Germany. Because at Koniggratz in 1866, tiny little Prussia defeated the Austrian Empire, which was much bigger, much larger economically and demographically than Prussia. And how was it able to do this? Essentially because of the genius of Helmut von Moltke and the German general staff, who figured out how to harness railroads, rifles, telegraphs, all these other technologies, and put them together into a war-winning plan. The Austrians had access to exactly the same technology, but they couldn't make use of it. And just think about how different history would have been if the Austrians, rather than the Prussians, had prevailed in 1866. You would not have had the rise of this Germany unified around Berlin with this Prussian militaristic class in control of Germany. And yet, that's what happened. And because of its success, Prussia, then Germany, was able to become the dominant power in Europe. And then you had something similar happening in the Far East, where Japan instantly leaped from being almost a medieval country into an industrialized one, and did it so successfully that in 1905, it was able to humble the Russian Empire, which is another one of the battles that I write about, the Battle of Tsushima. So again, tremendous upheavals at all different levels of global politics because of the First Industrial Revolution, culminating in World War I, where you had three ancient empires, the Romanovs, Habsburgs, and Ottomans, all collapsed essentially because they were not able to withstand the pressures of all-out industrialized warfare.
And the other fascinating insight that you have in this chapter is how the unintended consequence, the very success of Prussia and the validation of Moltke's organizational vision made the Prussian military totally dominant within the government, so that for the rest of the century and into World War I, the civilians had virtually no say. And we saw the dominance of technology driving strategy. The very fact that they could mobilize all these troops through their railroads, that they could provide all this firepower with basically American-designed machine guns that the American Army refused to equip their forces with, what drove this senseless slaughter and the destruction of Europe as it was known before that. It's just, there's so many really interesting insights in this chapter. I wish we had more time, but we'll go on to the second Industrial Revolution. And the tremendous revolution that the use of tanks, air, and terror had in the beginning of World War II.
Well, you had the essential technologies that formed the basis of the Second Industrial Revolution, were the internal combustion engine, as applied to automobiles, tanks, and airplanes, and then also the radio, which became this new instrument of command and control. And all of these technologies first began to make their impact felt on warfare around 1917 or so, but not really fully felt in World War I. Then you had the interwar period, and you had a time of tremendous technological change, and those who were best at taking advantage of it were, as we now know, the Germans in many ways, and the Japanese. And for the Germans, the impetus was simple. They lost World War I, and there's always this tremendous impetus for the loser to try harder, whereas the Allies won, and they were complacent. They didn't take advantage of the opportunities. The German ability to innovate was all the more remarkable considering how limited they were under the Treaty of Versailles in the 1920s. They were figuring out tank warfare at a time when they could not legally possess a single tank, or figuring out how to coordinate tanks and aircraft when they'd had neither tanks nor aircraft. Really an amazing feat, again, of the German General Staff, which allowed them to take what was a British invention, a tank, and employ it far more effectively than the British or the French did in 1939, 1940, 1941 in their blitzkrieg across Europe, which their advantage was truly in the realm of planning and execution. It wasn't in the equipment, because the Allies had very similar equipment. They had just as many tanks and airplanes, but the Allies didn't figure out certain basic things, like it would be important to put two-way radios into tanks and airplanes so you could maneuver forces in the field. Because for the Allies, they didn't worry about maneuver, because they were planning to fight this kind of static war of defense that they had fought in World War I. But the German General Staff figured it out, and this was the key advantage that allowed them to be so successful in the Battle of France and in the Battle of Poland and others. And something similar was happening on the other side of the world with Japan, which mastered aircraft carrier technology and naval aircraft in the interwar period. One of the battles that I write about is the raid on Pearl Harbor, which to us, of course, seems almost inevitable, because we view history with hindsight. But we have to remember what an amazing development this was in 1941, to think that you could have a fleet sailing all the way across the Pacific to attack this seemingly impregnable fortress in Hawaii, which was something that most American officers thought would never happen. But the Japanese were able to do it because they built tremendous aircraft carriers, and they had the wit to put them together into fleets centered around aircraft carriers, not centered around battleships, as had been done for decades before. So you had this tremendous upheaval in the early years of World War I, where the Axis were tremendously successful, essentially because in the interwar years, they had outthought the Allies. And so they were able to outfight the Allies very early on. But then you had a process of catching up, where the Americans and the Soviets in particular learned the tricks of the aggressors and were able to employ them even better than the Axis were, because they had more resources to bring to the fight.
One last chapter we want to talk about, or one section and one revolution, is the one we are still not in near the end of, and that is the information revolution. First brought home as a revolution to everybody in the world in Desert Storm. What would you like to expand on there?
Well, in some ways, Desert Storm was kind of the impetus for this book, because I'm sure, like everybody else in this room, was incredibly impressed by all these weapon systems that were unveiled in 1991, whether it was the GPS devices that allowed the left hook through the Iraqi desert to take place, or the stealth fighters that could penetrate Iraqi airspace unseen, or the most amazing innovation of all, smart bombs. I mean, this is something we take completely for granted, but you have to put this in perspective and realize that since the dawn of the gunpowder age, when a projectile left a gun barrel or left a bomb bay, it was pretty much on its own, and you couldn't control where it would fall. Therefore, they tended to be very inaccurate. In World War II, when my wife's grandfather was flying B-17s over Europe, you would be lucky if you can get within half a mile of the target. Therefore, if you wanted to eliminate, let's say, a German war plant, you would have to send 1,000 B-17s with 10,000 crewmen, and you would risk a significant portion of those in battle, and you still might not be able to put the plane out of production. By 1991, one airplane flown by one pilot dropping one bomb could achieve as much as 1,000 aircraft achieved in World War II. One stealth fighter could get a bomb on target with an incredibly high degree of accuracy, and not only on target. For those of you who are familiar with the workings of our Air Force, you know at these combined air operation centers, they think about not only how to hit a target, but do you want it to come in from the east or the west, impact the second floor or the third floor? I mean, truly science fiction type stuff for any bomber pilot or previous generation. It has become utterly routine today. But even though this is incredibly impressive, and there's so many other technologies that we've developed that are equally impressive, whether JSTARS and AWACS or Predators, all these amazing weapon systems, I think there was a kind of a feeling almost of hubris that set in the mid-1990s, which was, we have these cool toys, and nobody else does, and we can essentially wage push-button warfare, as we did in Bosnia and Kosovo. But what we're seeing now is what we've seen in every previous revolution in military affairs, which is that nobody's lead goes unchallenged, that other countries or even sub-state actors will find ways to copy the technology you have, or will adopt tactics that nullify your technological advantage. And we're seeing both happen right now with our enemies who are taking technology we invented and turning it against us, whether it's jumbo jets or the internet or satellite TV, all of which they use very effectively to wage global jihad. And they are figuring out ways to get around our defenses because they have learned the lesson that Saddam Hussein was too stupid to learn in 1991, which is do not fight the Americans on a conventional battlefield, because if you have conventional military equipment, we will kill it with our precision-guided munitions. What our enemies have learned is to not present a target for our amazing weapon systems. And so the dilemma we face, the paradox in many ways of the information age, we can destroy any target in the world, but we don't know which targets to destroy.
Well, the thing that struck me so much about this section is how well you again illustrate that these revolutions were not particularly seen as revolutions at the time. They were very, and really were very evolutionary, because the technology often preceded the actual realization of how to use it by a very long time. The bullpup missile, for instance, was operational in the Navy around 1960-61. This was a television-guided precision weapon. Laser-guided bombs were used in Vietnam in high numbers in 72, in the 72 offensive and the following year. Yet nobody realized how this could transform the way that military operations could be carried out. It took 30 years for that technology, which was in hand, to actually make its way through all the thinking at the most senior levels into the employment in a truly revolutionary strategy. And also the law of unintended consequences you illustrate so well, because there are no people who have learned the lessons of information warfare better than Al-Qaeda and our opponents, who better understand our vulnerabilities and how to use our technology, our cell phones and satellite phones and internet and the World Wide Web to be more agile and to get within what was the trendy Pentagon terminology not so long ago, to get inside our decision-making loop. And that's the challenge. How do we avoid this enabling technology that has produced such a revolution from being used decisively against us, and which is, as you say, following the pattern of history? Alas, that's the last that we can bloviate here. So the floor is now yours. Please keep the questions concise, to the point, and we will do the best to answer them. Who would like to ask the first question? Yes, please state your name and affiliation, and the microphone will be in your hand almost instantly.
It's Jim Creighton, United States Army. I'm on the council here. Max, your premise of revolution in military affairs is also followed by an evolution in tactics, techniques, and procedures. And as Mr. Lehman pointed out, we've been going through that for 30 years on figuring out how best to use these new technologies. Through your research, have you found any way to shorten the time of that evolution?
Well, I think the best way, unfortunately, to shorten an evolutionary cycle is to go into battle, because a lot of these ideas about how do you use technology are very theoretical until they face the test of battle. And I think what we're seeing now is a real sorting out process going on in Iraq and Afghanistan, where we are seeing the potential, but also, I'm afraid, the limitations of our technology. I think when the current administration came into office, they had very high hopes for what could be achieved by implementing this information revolution. And by basically orienting our defense dollars towards these precision, high-tech, long-range strike systems. So essentially, you would be able to wage push-button war, push a button and something blows up on the other side of the planet, and we wouldn't need as many troops. All you would need would be better machines. Now, what we found in Iraq is that is to some extent true for conventional warfare, and it's true that we can defeat conventional adversaries such as the Republican Guard with many fewer troops now than would have been necessary 10, 15, and certainly 20 or 30 years ago. The problem we're finding and the limitations of our technology is all of our high-tech systems are wonderful for getting you to Baghdad. But the question is, what do you do once you're in Baghdad? How do you control a country of 25 million people? And what we're seeing is that, F-16s and F-22s and M-1s and nuclear-powered aircraft carriers, these are all wonderful systems, and they all have their place. But they can't police a country the size of Iraq. For that, you have to have boots on the ground, and you have to have the right kinds of boots. And I think what I've seen in the course of the 4 years that I've been working on this book is a transformation of the idea of military transformation. Because when I started, I think it was a very much a technocentric concept, the notion that transformation was simply about how do you integrate the technology. Whereas now, I think there's greater realization. You have to figure out how to use the technology, and that to prevail in the kind of fight we now face, you don't just need smart bombs, you also need smart people and the right kind of people. And the challenge now is not so much to transform the weapons we have, but to transform the organization and the culture we have for utilizing those weapons. How do we get more people who understand Arabic or Pashto, who know how to deal with tribal sheikhs, who know who are experts in human intelligence or policing, all these other functions where we've been caught short in places like Iraq and Afghanistan. The technology is great, and we can utilize that as well. That's a big help. But we're not going to prevail against the enemies we face unless we get the organizational piece right. And that's the real challenge, I think, going forward. And that's, if there is one silver lining to what's happening in Iraq, which is a ghastly conflict that I think we're losing, unfortunately. But if there's one silver lining, it is that one of the best ways to foreshorten one of these development cycles is through the painful process of defeat, because defeat really concentrates the mind and forces you to think about what did you do wrong, what can you do right the next time. As I said, that's the process that led the Germans to early success in World War II, was their defeat in World War I. In many ways, it was what led us to success in Desert Storm, because it was a reaction to the defeat in Vietnam. Coming out of that, the reforms we made allowed us to be successful in Desert Storm in 1991. And so now the challenge is, can we be successful going forward in this kind of warfare for which we do not necessarily have the right organizational structure right now?
I think one of the areas where I need to spend more time with Max before his next book is on the issue of bureaucracy and its role in aiding or impeding the revolution in innovation in military tactics, because, well, everything Max says about bureaucracy is true. It is the half full, or I would even say maybe a sixth full part of the glass, whereas I believe bureaucracy today is the central challenge we face in learning lessons and applying them in our military affairs. And that's not just civilian bureaucracy, but especially military bureaucracy, because we have allowed the military staffs to grow to such huge size that they become a huge inertial moment against innovation and change, particularly the way the military operates, where you're assigned for 2 or 3 years and you've got to make a good fitness report, and you do not make it by knocking the railroad and by becoming a, quote, controversial person, unless you have a critical mass of really innovative, creative military leaders who protect the innovators and the real warfighters against the norms of the bureaucracy. I mean, it took 24 years for the Navy innovators to get the Aegis cruiser into the fleet from the time it was first started, resisted at every single turn. The same story can be told about the Tomahawk. It took nearly 20 years to get the Tomahawk in because every established bureaucracy had every reason to not fund it and block it. And the same is true of at the tactical level. There is a reason why the U.S. Army today looks like Napoleon's army in its organizational structure. Has nothing to do with the kind of threats it faces today, and everything to do with established momentum of bureaucratic organizations. That is a huge challenge to innovation and learning the lessons of this book. Yes.
David Braunschweig, Bureau of Stearns and Council on Foreign Relations. Max, could you tell us a little bit how you feel about overcoming the threat from technologies of intimidation that our adversaries might have? In the 1930s, Hitler and Mussolini innovated with their use of radio to mobilize support. De Gaulle, on June 18th, 1940, used the same technology to mobilize support in occupied France. Today, our adversaries have used the technologies of image to strike public opinion and to reverse public opinion in countries like Spain on March 11th. Following the success of the Viet Cong, the jihadists are trying to do the same thing in this country, i.e. fight public opinion on the home front with technologies. Is there anything we can do to avert that tactic and those strategies?
Well, you're absolutely right, David, about the importance of this new dimension of warfare. And it's really information operations, as they call it these days, or PSYOPs, as it used to be called, or whatever you want to call it. Basically, the propaganda battle is growing in importance largely because of the growth of information technology. This has been a long-term process going back to the 1850s and the first war correspondents coming along, because all of a sudden you had telegraphs to relay their dispatches back to their home newspapers. But then you've had constant ratcheting up from the introduction of radio and movie newsreels, to then television, the first TV war in Vietnam, to now the first internet war and the first satellite TV war, where the impact of information technology is much more immediate on the battlefield. And just one quick anecdote to illustrate that. The 2004 First Battle of Fallujah, where the Marines were fighting their way into Fallujah, when all of a sudden the offensive was called off. And why was it called off? It wasn't because the Marines were being beaten by these jihadist fighters that they were facing. I mean, these are some of America's toughest fighting men. They were going to prevail no matter what the odds were, but they were facing a different kind of enemy because their offensive was causing all of this hyped news coverage all over the world, driven by the Al Jazeera's and the like, about how they were allegedly killing men, women, and children, and raising mosques and all this kind of stuff. And the determination was made in Baghdad and Washington to call off the offensive, lest they suffer more public relations damage. And I thought Jim Conway, who was the commander of the 1st Marine Expeditionary Force in charge of the offensive, had a very telling comment that illustrates the point you're making, which is Jim Conway said, "We got our butts kicked by Al Jazeera." Now, I mean, just think about that. The U.S. Marine Corps got its butts kicked by a television network. But that is the reality of warfare today, and we're not very good at it. Our enemies, in many ways, are much more adept at manipulating images than we are. When you go to the Pentagon and you ask who's in charge of information warfare, you'd be looking around for a while because there is nobody in charge. It's not something that's recognized or has been recognized as a major combat competency, and yet it has to be. Now we're taking some small faltering steps towards trying to address some of our problems, with the State Department, for example, setting up a sort of quick reaction center of diplomats who speak Arabic and can appear on Al Jazeera and the like. But I mean, we're really at stage one of dealing with this issue, and our enemies are several stages ahead of us, and we'd better figure this out, because this is really what happens on the modern battlefield, and not only for us, it's what happened to the Israelis this summer when they were battling Hezbollah. They were defeating Hezbollah militarily, but they were losing the war of images. And these days, the war of images can be more important than the actual battlefield. So I don't have a magic solution for it, but we have to place more emphasis on it, and part of it is organizational, and realizing we have to develop more people who are skilled and competent in this area of warfighting, just as we have people who are skilled in traditional, more traditional areas of warfighting.
Jason Chaplin, I had the pleasure of taking a CONUS trip with Max a couple years back. Max, I'd like to ask you about the intersection of information technology and something else you know a great deal about, and that's joint forces fighting. I imagine the technology we're using today has made that significantly easier in many respects as systems and branches of the military talk to each other. I think it's probably presented some challenges, too, as systems have trouble integrating. I wonder if you could give us a scorecard of where we are on that, information technology and how it's advanced joint forces fighting, but also some of the challenges to making that more effective, or what's impeding that, particularly perhaps as respect to bureaucracy, as Mr. Lehman has talked about.
Well, I think we've made tremendous strides in the last few years in trying to get different services to work together. I mean, it really goes back to the Goldwater-Nichols Act in 86, but it's been a long-term process, and a few years ago you had the creation of the Joint Forces Command, which is tasked with looking in particular at these issues and how do you integrate the different services. I mean, there's still challenges out there. I mean, in 2003 in Iraq, during the Battle of Amnas Syria, you had the 1st Marine Division and Task Force Tarawa, these two different Marine units from two different parts of the country, one from the East Coast, one from the West Coast. They couldn't communicate with one another because they didn't have radio set on the same frequencies. So obviously, we have a ways to go, but I think we are making rapid progress on that. What we're finding, though, is new issues of interoperability being raised, even as our services get more joint and there's much closer integration, in particular, between air and ground, which you certainly see on an everyday basis. But you're seeing a huge gap open up between ourselves and our coalition allies, and it's very hard for countries we may operate with, whether the Germans, Italians, British, or others, to be interoperable with our forces because they don't have all the cool stuff that we have, and they don't spend that much on defense, and it's going down, so they can't get all the cool stuff that we have, and so this creates real tensions and frictions within the relationship. Now, I think those countries can still bring tremendously valuable forces to the field because many of the challenges we face, as I mentioned before, in places like Iraq or Afghanistan, are not technological per se. You need good policing, you need good counterinsurgency experience, things that, for example, the British have in spades, even though they may not have the most sophisticated equipment as we have. But nevertheless, this creates problems, and these are things that we have to work on. I think the biggest thing that I would say, the biggest challenge, is getting technology down to the warfighter. Because we're very good at the high end. We can get all these predator feeds into headquarters in Tampa and Cotter and places like that where commanders can sit around watching on predator feeds of live action happening on the battlefield with predators being flown by guys sitting in a trailer at Nellis Air Force Base in Las Vegas and operating them over Afghanistan. I mean, stuff truly out of a Tom Clancy novel. But the question is, are you getting that information down to the lowest, to the ordinary grunt on the ground, the guy with the M16 who has to try to affect what happens in Fallujah or Baghdad or places like that? And the answer is often no, we're not. That the warfighters on the ground often have to rely on FM radios that aren't very different from what their forefathers were using in World War II. So we're very good on some levels of technology, and we've made strides in interoperability. But I think the challenge now is to get the technology down to a usable level so the average soldier has a much higher level of technology, and not just soldier, airmen, Marines, all sailors, all the rest of it.
Yes.
Jason Tepperman from Baker Capital. In listening to the description of the different technologies, it was striking that whether munitions or tanks or other technologies that cause destruction seem to have been developed much more effectively than technologies that defend against destruction, whether missiles versus missile defense or IEDs versus our defense against them. Do you think that's generally true, first? And second, if so, in a country that's increasingly concerned with homeland security, is there a way to bridge that asymmetry?
Very good question. I think what you traditionally see is an action-reaction cycle where the you may see developments of offensive technology, which then leads to a development of defensive technology, going all the way back to the very first example I cited, the French invasion of Italy in 1494. The French were tremendously successful in using their cannons to knock down Italian castle walls. But within 50 years or so, a lot of the advantage of cannons had been negated because you saw the construction of different kinds of castles, artillery bastions essentially with interlocking fields of fire, integrating artillery into the defense of the castle, and so they became much harder to knock down. I mean, you've seen similar arms races happen many times, like in the early 20th century where you saw the race between the increasing firepower of naval guns and the increasing thickness of armor on battleships. Today, I think you're absolutely right that the offensive has the advantage over the defensive, in particular with even on a conventional battlefield with guided technologies, tanks don't do you that much good anymore, at least not as much good as they used to do against the high-tech foe. We can destroy tanks left, right, and center with great ease, and it's not only us. In Lebanon and this summer, you saw that Hezbollah now has access to advanced Russian guided missiles for anti-tank warfare, like the Cornet and the Sagar, which are tremendously effective in taking out even advanced Israeli armor, or they managed to take out an Israeli guided missile warship as well with a Chinese-designed cruise missile. And you're seeing the proliferation of these kinds of cruise missiles and technologies all over the world in ballistic missiles and in many other different forms. The defensive technology still lags behind, as you can see from the fact that we've spent over 20 years trying to develop ballistic missile defenses, and they're still not very effective. Now, I think that overall, we will finally someday get ballistic missile defense right, and the North Korean threat, for example, will be an impetus for that. I mean, it's an engineering problem, and we can solve engineering problems. What really concerns me is that there are not obvious defenses to a lot of the irregular asymmetric threats that we face, i.e., I am reasonably confident that before long we will be able to stop a nuclear-tipped ballistic missile aimed at L.A. or New York. But are we going to be able to stop a nuclear suitcase smuggled in via Mexico or Canada? I have much less confidence that that will be the case. Now, there are technologies that can help us with that. For example, data mining, although that raises all sorts of privacy questions, but we have tremendously powerful computer systems that can analyze what our enemies do, or nanotechnology. I mean, developments in nanotech will perhaps make available ubiquitous miniature sensors that you can put everywhere, essentially, to detect explosives of all kinds. All of these things are tremendously useful, and we should develop them and use our advantage as much as possible. But ultimately, I have very little confidence that they will provide a foolproof defense any more than the Maginot Line did. Our enemies will figure out ways around it, and ultimately, the only way we're going to defeat the enemies we face is to get inside their heads, figure out what they're up to, and figure out how to stop them before they can carry out their plan. And as far as I know, there is still no machine capable of getting inside somebody else's head. That still comes back to the issue I raised before, which is having smart people. And, you know, in connection with that and with John's tremendous work on the 9/11 Commission, it is not reassuring to read in the Washington Post, as I did a few weeks ago, that 5 years after 9/11, the FBI has something like 33 agents who speak Arabic out of 12,000 special agents altogether, and even many of those 33 don't actually speak it that well. So that bespeaks to me some larger failure in the system, which is what John was alluding to, of how do we organize, how do we train, how do we recruit, how do we set up our very government for the kinds of conflicts that we face. And that's the ultimate challenge. It's not technology, it's getting the organization structure right, and if we do that, the technology will follow.
Yeah, I think the fundamental problem that we identified, as rediscovering the wheel in the 9/11 report, was a failure of imagination because of the ponderous nature and the real obsoleteness of our government structures. We have a government that grew out, is a product of the Treaty of Westphalia, as Kissinger often points out. It's a nation-state organization that grew in its current manifestations out of the Cold War to deal with national threats, national enemies, missiles that can be counted, and hardware that can be calculated, orders of battle, and so forth. And the way we clear people in, anyone that speaks Arabic today is highly unlikely to be able to get through the screens because they have to hire people, or they have to get them cleared. It takes 3 years to hire someone who made 5 or 6 trips to the Middle East to study Arabic. So people that need to recruit people for next year's class don't want those people. They just want corn-fed Aryans with no history and no background and no complications that they can recruit and train up their own way. And of course, you get what you train. And unfortunately, that is a fundamental challenge that runs through every part of our national security challenge today. Yes, sir.
Thank you, John Temple Swing. Max, I'd like to take you back, if I can, to the First Battle of Fallujah, and your quote of the Marine Colonel, in the sense, we were beaten by Al Jazeera. I wonder if that isn't a bit of a simplification. Some of us who were looking at the First Battle of Fallujah were throwing up our hands and pulling out our hair simply because the Marines were going into Fallujah as they were destroying a city of 100,000 people. And if the battle in Iraq is indeed to capture the hearts and minds of the Iraqis, that's not a very good way to do it. So somewhere in there, there is a failure of communication of what the mission is. I mean, there's no question the Marines could have wiped out Fallujah. That I take that as a given. But we're fighting the same problem now in the final plan for the present plans in Iraq. So how do we win the hearts and minds of the Iraqis in the next 3 months when we have to go in and pacify it and then start rebuilding? And this is something that we simply are not very good at and have not anticipated.
All right. Well, I don't really dispute that. There were huge failures up and down the line on the First Battle of Fallujah, as there have been throughout the war in Iraq. And I don't really blame the Marines for it because they were ordered into an offensive they didn't want to undertake, basically because of a political snap judgment made in Baghdad and Washington, and in part a judgment made without calculating what you're talking about, which is the political and psychological ramifications of this all-out offensive into the city, which ramifications that were certainly foreseeable in advance and should have been foreseen by the decision makers. It wasn't the Marines on the ground, it was the higher ups, but there's no question that the offensive was stopped because they didn't calculate those consequences, and it kind of blew up in everybody's face, at least on a, not necessarily on a military level, but on a political and diplomatic level. But I mean, that just goes to the larger point, which is how important all these factors are in warfare, and how we have neglected them in places like Iraq at our peril. In large part, this is what we're paying the price for in some ways is our previous 15 or so years of success, because, you know, after Vietnam, we got out of this horrible conflict and the military was really remade with the all-volunteer system, all sorts of new weapon systems, whether M1s or F-15s or Aegis cruisers or all the rest of it, the Goldwater-Nichols Act, new training centers, all this amazing transformation that I write about in my book, which produced the best conventional military in the world. And we were able to ride along on that from Desert Storm up until 9/11. But what we're realizing now is it's taking us back to a lot of the old lessons of Vietnam, which we forgot after Vietnam because essentially I think the leadership of the country and of the armed forces basically said, we don't ever want to fight this kind of war again. We're going to forget everything we know about counterinsurgency. We're going to rip up our counterinsurgency manuals, in some cases literally, and we're going to focus on another kind of war, which we did, tremendously successful. But now we're paying the price for being so good at this one kind of war and not so good at the other, because our enemies get a vote in what kind of war we fight, and the more that we demonstrate our prowess at high-end conventional conflict, the less likely it is that anybody will challenge us in that high-end sphere. They will go to the low-end, low-intensity conflict. But that's becoming a greater and greater danger because, as we've been talking in the last few minutes, the power at the hands of guerrillas is just expanding exponentially. I mean, when you think about what could guerrillas do 100 years ago, it wasn't very much. I mean, one of the battles I write about in my book is the Battle of Omdurman in 1898, when the British were facing a jihadist insurgency in the Sudan that in some ways resembles the passions we see in the Arab world today. But the military capabilities of these jihadists were so limited, and the capabilities of the British were so great, that the Battle of Omdurman was one of the most one-sided military defeats in history, where General Kitchener, with his machine guns and repeating rifles, just mowed down thousands of dervishes. That's not the case today, because today the dervishes, and in some cases the literal descendants of the very people who were fighting the British in 1898, are no longer confined to a battlefield in the Sudan or Afghanistan or Iraq. We have, for our sins, we have knit the world closer together. We have pushed this globalization phenomenon, and these folks are as much the beneficiaries of it as Microsoft Dell or eBay is. So their capabilities, their destructive capabilities, their ability to move around the world and to cause havoc at any point around the world has grown exponentially. So I would argue that figuring out how to do guerrilla warfare right, figuring out how to do counterinsurgency, is not a luxury. It's a necessity. We have to figure it out if we're going to defend our own homeland against the threats that we confront.
Yes, sir. Three last questions, you.
Thank you. Tom Clore, Council on Foreign Relations and the Navy Fellows, are here at the Council. Max, I'd like to follow up your comment there that says, well, we're going to prepare and we're going to focus on this counterinsurgency, low-intensity counterinsurgency type of warfare. Where's the danger in that we will spend the next 20 years focusing on that and ignore the technologies when in 20, 30, 40, 50 years we have a peer competitor now that we have now trained a whole generation of officers on how to work in a village, but we don't know how to sail into a bay?
That's a totally legitimate concern, and I want to be clear about what I'm saying. I'm not one of these zealots for so-called fourth-generation warfare who says, you know, let's throw away all the aircraft carriers, let's chunk the tanks, let's blow up the F-22s, and all we need are a bunch of lean and mean ground pounders. Well, I think we do need those ground pounders, but we also do need the higher-end systems. I mean, you have to have balance. It's a question of where do you draw the balance. At the moment, I would say we have a pretty comfortable advantage over any potential adversary in conventional conflict, but we can't stand still and expect that advantage to last indefinitely. And there's no question that countries like China are innovating right now to figure out how to not necessarily defeat our Navy, for example, in a one-on-one battle, but how to deny our Navy access to the Taiwan Straits, whether using cruise missiles, submarines, all these other access denial technologies. And we better figure out the right counters to that. Otherwise, we may wake up 20 or 30 years from now in a conflict with China that doesn't go nearly as well as we would hope. And the real danger there is not how we will do in the conflict, but if we don't keep this superiority on the conventional end of warfare, that makes a war more likely. That makes it more likely that somebody will challenge us in precisely that way. So we have to keep that advantage, and I don't argue for standing still. But at the moment, I think we have a very comfortable lead in the conventional arena, whereas we're far behind in the irregular warfare end of the spectrum. And so I think we need to concentrate more of our attention there. And it's not, by the way, mainly a matter of money or resources, although I do think we need more soldiers. I think our army just cannot meet all the challenges it faces, having been downsized 30% in the 1990s. We need more troops, and they're not cheap. But that's the only major expense that I foresee on the lower end of warfare. The real challenge there is not spending money, but it's figuring out the right organizational structure, the right career patterns. How do you get officers through the system who speak Arabic and can parlay with tribal sheikhs? It's very difficult to do when we have this kind of cookie-cutter promotion system right now where everybody spends 2 years at every assignment and keeps going from the field to staff jobs to schools, and they have to be sort of conversant with all skills and not truly expert in any one of those. And so it makes it very hard to develop, for example, the kind of cultural knowledge that we need. So I think, I mean, going back to the point that John was making about, you know, how do we recruit not just military personnel, but FBI agents, diplomats, spies, people throughout the government, how do we coordinate their activities more closely together? This is, by the way, another element of interoperability and jointness that I forgot to mention, is simply getting all the different services of the government to work together so that DOD and state and CIA and others are on the same page. That's a huge challenge. So all of these things would go a long way towards correcting a lot of our problems on the lower end of warfare. And we can continue to have a Navy and an Air Force which are primarily oriented towards the higher end threats, deterring as much as fighting them. And I think that's We need both of those. We can't just say one or the other.
I'm afraid we've run out of time. I promised two more questioners. They'll get the first shot at the author at the wine bar. So thank you very much for your attention. Sacrificing at least the next 7 days of talking to give us this great evening. Thank you.
Thank you for being patient.